Hello everyone, this is Mirzai from Cal Poly Pomona, and in this lesson we're going to learn about basic and non-basic variables in addition to the mechanic of simplex method. Basically, we want to know how simplex works the way it does. Okay, suppose that we have a linear programming problem as shown on the screen. You have the objective function that is a minimization, and you have three constraints for this problem. Now let's just start by standardizing this problem. Before you watch this video, I expect you to watch the video regarding the simplex method. So if you haven't watched that video, you might have a little bit of hard time understanding the rest of the content in this video. So I highly recommend you to watch the video regarding the solution of a linear programming problem using the simplex method, and then come back here to understand why we implement this step the way that we do. Now, to standardize this problem, in the simplex lecture, we learned that we have to add slack variables to three constraints of this problem and bring everything in the left-hand side for the objective function. So I'm going to go ahead and standardize this problem. And also, we know that all the decision variables must be greater than or equal to zero. This is one of the basic assumptions of linear programming problem. Now, for the time being, I want you to dismiss the objective function equation. And suppose that we only have a system of now seven decision variables and three constraints. Now, if I have the system of equation, we can solve this system, but one of the challenges that we have is that we have seven variables and only we have three equations. So we're missing four equations to solve the system of equation. The question is, how can we solve a system of equations with seven variables and three equations? Typically, the way that we deal with that is that we put four variables equal to zero as many variables that we don't have equation for them. So right now we are missing four equations, so we put four variables equal to zero and we solve the system for the three remaining unknown variables and three equations that we have. That is doable for us. So the four variables that we put equal to zero in the context of linear programming problem, they are called non-basic variables. And the three variables that we choose to solve the system of equation for them, they are called basic variables. So let's move on to the next slide. I bring the same system of equation here. Also, we have the condition that all of these decision variables are positive. Now, how many ways can we choose three variables out of the seven to solve the system of equation? The answer is the combination of 3 out of 7, which is 35 ways. So there are 35 different ways that we can pick 3 variables out of the pool of 7 and find a solution to the system of equations. But some of these answers or solutions that we find, there might not be a feasible solution because they might not hold the condition that all these variables must be positive. Because some of these solutions might have negative values for any of these decision variables. So not all the 35 solutions that we find are a feasible solution to the system of equation. Now let's pick three of these decision variables and solve the system of equation for them. So in example one, I assume that the four decision variables that are equal to zero are x1 through x4, and therefore the answer to the system of equation simply will be the slack variable of the first constraint equal to 50, the second slack equal to 42, and the third one is equal to 250. This is basically the initial simplex table. What happens in the various initial table of the simplex, you assume that all your main variables are equal to zero and your excess or slack variables are positive. So that's the initial simplex table feasible solution. So now suppose that we pick another four variables randomly and put them equal to zero. So in the second example, I chose x1, x4, s1, and s2 equal to 0, and I solve the system of equations for the rest of the variables that we have. Again, remember those that we put equal to 0 are non-basic variables. The one that we solve the system of equation for them, they're called basic variables. So in this case, my basic variables are going to be x2, x3, and s3. So if I consider the system of equation and put 0 for x1, x4, s1, and s2, you have this reduced system of equation that has three decision variables, three equations. And the answer for the basic variables in this case is going to be x2 equal to 14, x3 equal to 36, and s3 is equal to 128. Now, this is the answer to this system of equation, but we can go on and find all the 35 ways to find 35 solution, but remember, we had an objective function at the beginning that we dismissed. So we are not just solving the system of equation, but we are solving the system of equation with respect to some sort of objective or goal that we have in mind. And that objective is to minimize this objective function. Now, which one of these two solutions gives me a better answer in terms of minimizing the value of z? If I plug in the value of decision variables from the first solution into the objective function, z is going to be equal to 0. And if I replace the value of this decision variables into the objective function, the answer to z for the second example is going to be negative 264. And if I'm trying to minimize this objective function, you see that the second solution is a better solution. But simplex method doesn't want to go through the all possible alternatives and find the best solution. It's working its way toward the best solution in a kind of a smart manner. So the question that the simplex method trying to answer is basically increasing what variable will improve the objective function. So if I look at the objective function value, and if I think that I can increase the value of any of these decision variables, x1, x2, and x4, which one would I increase to minimize the objective function value? So you see that if I increase x1 or x2, the value of objective function increases. However, if I increase the value of x4 because of its negative coefficient here, the value of objective function is going to decrease and it's going to be in the favor of my objective function, which is a minimization. So therefore, we would like to increase x4. That's why what you do at the simplex table where you're dealing with a minimization problem, you find the most positive in the row of z. Why? Because when you standardize this problem, the negative coefficient of 5 turns into a positive coefficient. So basically the most positive in the row of z, indeed showing the variable with the most negative contribution to your objective function. And you can think about it the other way for a maximization. If this was a maximization, increasing these two would be in the benefit of objective function, and you would choose x2 over x1 because x2 had a higher contribution to the objective function. And therefore, when it comes down to maximization, you're looking for the most negative in the row of z as opposed to the most positive for the minimization. So that explains why we do what we do in the selection of the entering decision variable in the simplex table. Now, the second question that we have to answer to solve this problem using the simplex method is that now we know that increase in x4 is going to go toward the minimization of this objective function. But how much I can increase x4? What is the maximum amount that I can put for x4? Because it seems that if I increase x4, I'm going to minimize my objective function. So let's bring the system of equations that we have here. So we have to answer this question by looking at the system of equation. In the first constraint, you don't see any x4. So basically, the amount that you can increase x4 in the first constraint is positive infinity. You can increase x4 to positive infinity and yet satisfy this equation, basically. If you look at the second constraint, you see that the maximum amount that you can increase x4 is equal to 42. Consider that everything else here is 0, and the maximum that you can increase x4 is going to be 42. If I look at the third constraint, you see that the coefficient of an x4 is negative. And that means you can increase this the amount of x4 to infinity again and compensate that by increasing the value of other decision variables here and still hold the system of equations here. So the answer from the first and third constraint for the amount that is possible to increase x4 is infinity. But for the second constraint is only 42. So if I look at the intersection of all these possible increase, the maximum amount that you can increase x4 so that all three constraints are intact is 42. And that's exactly what happens in minimum test. You basically ignore the rows that have zero or negative sign, and you only include the one with the positive sign to calculate the value for minimum test, because in the minimum test you're trying to find the maximum amount of increase in the decision variables that has the highest contribution toward the improvement of your objective function. So therefore, it doesn't matter if you're looking at a minimization or a maximization, you're always trying to find how much you can increase the variable that contributes toward the improvement of your objective function. So therefore, by these two methods, picking the most contributing decision variables and the improvement of objective function, which are most positive and a minimization and most negative and maximization, and also implementing the minimum test, simplex take a very smart approach toward finding the basic feasible solutions that take us to the optimal solution in the fastest possible way. So simplex doesn't end up with any infeasible solution, because in the first place, the min test doesn't allow us to increase our decision variables so that we have to compensate those increase by creating negative values in other decision variables. So as a result, simplex doesn't search the whole 35 basic solution to this problem. It just search the subset that is feasible, and it does it in a calculated manner that reduces the search for us. And as a result, in a few steps, we are able to get to the optimal feasible solution of the problem. With this, our lesson in basic and non-basic variables and simplex mechanics has concluded. Please refer to your blackboards for your assignments. Thank you.